is, can a Christian have an evil spirit? For long, the church has debated this question. Can a Christian have an evil spirit? How can a Christian have an evil spirit? How can the evil spirit and the Holy Spirit of God be in the same room? That is an abomination. Today, we are going to answer that question and more. But the more common question that people ask is, can a Christian be demon-possessed? That is the one that people have asked for years. And people have said, no, a Christian cannot be demon-possessed. I agree with the second one. A Christian can never be demon-possessed. Never. Why? Because demon possession implies ownership. It implies ownership. I want us to read together 1 Peter chapter 1, and I'm going to read verses 18 and 19. 1 Peter chapter 1, and I'm going to read verses 18 and 19. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers. To redeem means to exchange something, to pay something, and to get something else in exchange. That is what God did for you if you are born again. In 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20, we are told, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? And God's Spirit lives in you. He says, you are not your own. You are bought with a price. God bought you. So you cannot belong to Satan and belong to God at the same time. A Christian is Jesus possessed. Okay? Not demon possessed. Christian is Jesus possessed. We are possessed by Jesus Christ. So the correct question is what we are asking today. Can a Christian be controlled by, from the outside, or have an evil spirit on the inside? And by the time you're leaving, you are going to be able to answer that question to the people who did not come to this teaching. Did not come to this teaching. We are going to look at Jesus' first encounter with evil spirits in his earthly ministry. I want us to know, first of all, what are evil spirits? Where did they come from? Did Jesus encounter them? Did the early church encounter them? Those spirits that were encountered in the early church, where are they today? Are they sleeping? Will they leave the earth? We are going to find out. Christians are followers of Jesus. And what does that mean? That means that we follow in our conduct what Jesus did. That is what makes me a follower of Jesus. So today, we want to follow Jesus as he is preaching and teaching and dealing with evil spirits. And we're going to see how is he doing it. How he did it is how we are expected to do it. Let us go together to Mark. Mark chapter 1. And today we're going to stay a lot in the book of Mark. Because Mark talked a lot and recorded a lot about how Jesus dealt with evil spirits. Mark chapter 1 in verse 16 says, I'll read 16 to 19. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Jesus is now looking for followers. And he tells them something very important. This is the only thing Jesus says to all of us. And he said it to his disciples. He said, come follow me. Come follow me. Why? Why follow Jesus? And he tells them why. He says, and I will make you fishers of men. That is all. The whole Bible, everything that we do is so that we can be fishers of men. If we go through deliverance, it's so that we can be fishers of men. If we are studying the word of God, it is so that we can be fishers of men. We are told at once they left their nets and followed him. Okay? When they had gone a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. And he also called to them. Without delay, he called them. And they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. So how many people are following Jesus now? A There's Andrew, who else? There is John and James. So far, he only has four disciples. And remember, he said, come follow me. Follow me where? They followed him into the synagogue. So we see in verse 21. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath day came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. Remember, he's telling them, come and follow me so that I can make you fishers of men. So the implication is Jesus is saying, look at me. I am teaching you how to be a fisher of men. Everything you see me do now is to teach you how to be a fisher of men. Verse 22. Okay? So he was there in the synagogue teaching. The people were amazed at his teaching, and because he taught them as one who had authority and not as the teachers of the law. These four disciples were used to the teachers of the law, and they saw something different in Jesus. He saw that Jesus taught with authority. So he's telling them, if you want to be fishers of men, you must teach and preach with authority. Because the other people, the teachers of the law, did not teach with authority. And so it amazed no one. But they were amazed. What happened when Jesus taught with authority? What happens when you and I teach with authority? He says, just then, a man in the synagogue who was possessed by an evil spirit cried out. Now, it says that in the Greek, it doesn't mean possessed. It means demonized. Okay? Demonized is to have an evil spirit, not to be possessed, but the NIV says possessed, and many actually Bible say possessed, but it's actually demonized, which is to be with an evil spirit. So when Jesus Christ taught, his teaching was evil spirits could not sit anymore in that teaching with authority. This man had been coming to the synagogue probably for a long time. Not once did the demons bother with what they were saying. Probably sleeping. Then they wake each other up when the man is leaving. The last chorus, isn't it? Yeah? But this, even the demons, my goodness, the demons tried to keep quiet because they knew if Jesus knows that we are here, he's going to kick us out. Until they couldn't help it. So the man cried out. Okay? And he says, what do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? What do you want with us? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God. Okay? As soon as preaching with authority, there's a reason I'm telling you this. As soon as you go out to preach with authority, you are going to encounter evil spirits. Because they're not going to be able to hide any longer. They are going to cry out. And you're going to see the different ways in which they cry out. And remember, Jesus has called these people and told them, follow me. Let me teach you how to be a fisher of men. But Jesus told them very sternly, said, be quiet, come out of him. Verse 26, the evil spirit shook the man violently. Okay? I can just imagine chairs scattering and people running away in that synagogue. Because he was being shaken violently. They had never seen anything like this before. Never. Then it says, and the spirit came out of the man with a shriek. You can imagine. Somebody, what? You have never had anything like that in your life before. So what did they say? They were all amazed. They said, hey, what is this? Are you teaching? Isn't that what we hear people say these days? When you hear that somebody was kicking out evil spirits, what is this? Are you teaching? Huh? What is this new teaching? With the church, we are very quiet. And nothing happens. We keep the evil spirits very quiet in us. What is this person coming and now causing them to shriek? Do you understand? He says, and with authority. That impressed them. It was with authority. Okay? Then they said, he even gives orders to evil spirits and they obey him. Before this time, no one had really dealt with evil spirits and the evil spirits obeyed them. Maybe they saw people trying to kick out evil spirits, but the evil spirits did not obey them. But now for the first time, they are seeing evil spirits obey Jesus. There are certain things that we can pick from this passage. Number one, because remember we are trying to be fishers of men. So we are being told, number one, if you have to be a fisher of men, you must first of all teach the word of God with authority. Teach teach the word of God with authority. B, if you teach the word with authority, you're going to start to disturb evil spirits amongst people that you are preaching to. This was not outside. They probably thought evil spirits were in the mad people at the asylum. But they found out this evil spirit was very comfortable in the church. It was a religious spirit. Didn't mind the choruses, didn't mind the teaching that was very quiet and, you know, making people just not their comfort be uncomfortable. But as soon as it was preached with authority, okay, to teach with authority, you're going to disturb evil spirits. Remember, Jesus is training them. See, they're learning to follow Jesus. They were learning how to deal with evil spirits. Imagine he calls them, and the very first thing that he teaches them is how to deal with evil spirits. Very first meeting, dealing with evil spirits. Okay? And then he's teaching them, when you encounter an evil spirit, kick it out. Because remember, they're watching. These things are all new to them. But they're saying, wow, when you encounter that evil spirit, Jesus is teaching them, kick it out. Then after that, they leave the synagogue and they go to Simon Peter's house. Verse 29. Says, as soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. And what do they find there? Remember, they are being trained how to be fishers of men. They are told Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever. And they told Jesus about her. And after that, they went and got her water and aspirin. Is that what they got her? No. And they told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand and held her up, and the fever left her and she began to wait on them. Think of how it impacted this woman. You just found a sick person and you're going to lay hands on them and they become well. Remember, he's being trained. I want you to see what is important to Jesus. Okay? And then now we go to verse 32. Very early in the morning, remember they're in Simon's house. Very early in the morning when it was dark, Jesus gets up and he leaves the house and he goes to a very solitary place where he can pray. He's also teaching them about prayer. Being a fisher of man, isn't it? He wakes up early and he goes to pray. And then that Simon and his disciples went to look for him. Why? When they found him, they said, everyone is looking for you. Okay? Everyone is looking for you. Why? I'll tell you why. We jump back to verse 32. Because that evening, when they were in Simon's house, it says, after sunset, people brought to Jesus all the sick and demonized. This is the first time they've seen this thing happening in a synagogue. So they found out where this man is going to sleep. And he says, people brought to them the sick and the demonized. Because they realized, what? The problems that we've been having now can be solved? People who have been disturbing us with demons can now be healed? They cannot be delivered. And then we are told what? And the whole town gathered at the door. Jesus was telling them, do you know the problem that you've been living with? You've been looking at these people assuming they're all okay. You've been assuming they've got no problems. But look at this. He says the whole town. The Bible does not lie. If it's the whole town, it was done. The whole of Nairobi was on the Gold Road. Policemen, uncle, coming, traffic policemen, what is going on? He says the whole town gathered. And who did they bring? Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons. So we are told this is a problem of the multitude. This was a problem of the town. They were sick and there was no one healing them. They were demon possessed or demonized. And there was no one who knew how to drive out those demons. So Jesus is showing his disciples the problem of the multitudes. The problem, when you look at a crowd like this, what is the problem? There are multitude of problems there. There are those who are sick. There are those who are struggling with demons. We are going to see how we struggle with demons. He says, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Then that is why early the next morning he went out. Why? Because he was, but you can imagine by the time he has dealt with the whole town, he's very tired, isn't it? And how does he, when he's tired, he went to do what? He went to sleep, no? When he's tired, he's teaching them, when you're tired, you'll get your rejuvenation from the Lord. Do you understand? When you're tired, you go to the mountain and get your rejuvenation from the mountain. Okay? And then we are told in verse 38, then Jesus replied, let us go somewhere else to the nearby villages so I can preach there also. It always starts with the preaching. Because Jesus knows, if he starts with the preaching, he doesn't have to coerce demons, they will manifest. Because the teaching drives them out. Okay? As soon as you start teaching with authority, people start sleeping. I want you to understand, today we are talking about spiritual warfare and how to deal with evil spirits. Today we are learning how to be fishers of men. As soon as powerful preaching starts in any church, look around. Isn't it? Yes! It's true. Why? Because there is spiritual warfare. The demons are now being stirred. Because they don't want the person to hear the teaching. Why? Because the truth sets you free. Yes. It says you shall hear the truth and the truth shall set you free. Yes. And they don't want the person to hear the truth. Because if the person is set free, they will lose their home. Okay? Verse 39. So he traveled throughout Galilee, doing two things. Two things. Jesus wants to show them that his main mission, why he came to the earth. He says, preaching in their synagogues, driving out demons. And yet, it is something that the church is very silent about.
That's true.
Something as important as that to Jesus, the church is silent about. Jesus is saying, I came from to preach. And because I know once I preach, the demons will come up. When they come up, I kick them out. Okay? To preach and to kick out evil spirits. Evil spirits, now I'm telling this to move on because later on I may forget to come back to it. Evil spirits always have a strong man. You will never find one lone evil spirit sitting there alone like this. Never. There is always the captain, the strong man. And then there are the little lesser demons under the strong man. And the little lesser demons listen to the strong man. So let us go back to that same story in the synagogue. He says, what do you want with us? Verse 34, Jesus of Nazareth. Have you come to destroy us? That is plural, isn't it?
Yes.
That is, the strong man says what? I know who you are. Not we know who you are. The strong man speaks up. He says, I know who you are. Have you come to destroy us, me, and the people under me? Okay? You know, when you see one, you know there are many others that are working with that one. They are teaching us how to identify evil spirits and how to deal with them. Okay? Even in the story of the demoniac, they said, he's talking to Jesus. He says, I, when Jesus says, what is your name? He says, my name is Legion. My, one, because we are many. We are many under the strong man called Legion. Okay? So there's always a group of evil spirits and a one main one. Now I want to talk about the mission for the 12 apostles. What was the mission for the 12 apostles? We're going to look at Mark chapter 3. And I'm going to look from verse 13. Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted. And they came to him. He appointed 12. Originally there were 4, now there are 12. Designating them to be apostles. Then we are told the 3 reasons why he called them. Reason number 1, that they might be with him. They might be with him. Why? So they can see the way he does things. He says there are some principles that are not taught, they are caught. As I look at you, I'm able to catch the way you're doing things. So the first thing he did was that they might be with him. Number 2, that he might send them out to preach. So to be with him, and then to preach. And the third thing, and you have authority to drive out demons. If your church is not teaching you that, they are not giving you the full gospel. This is the full gospel. To be with Jesus. To preach good news. To have authority over evil spirits. And he had to give them authority because he knew if I tell them to preach, they're going to encounter evil spirits. So I must also give them authority to deal with the evil spirits. Those three things. Okay? And after that, he goes on, these were 12. Verse 16. We've already been told the three things that God, that Jesus called the apostles to do. If you're doing number one and two, you're doing two-thirds of what you are supposed to do. Supposed to be with Jesus. Have a relationship with him. Be close to him. You're supposed to, after being close to him, after looking at him, go back and tell people what you have seen. And if you go and tell people what you have seen, evil spirits will not be happy with you. They will start manifesting. And when they manifest, you deal with them. Okay? Those are the 12 apostles. We look at chapter 6 as well. And I'm going to start with 6b and then go on to 7. He says, Jesus sends out the 12. Now he has 12 and he's sending them out. What is his mission for these 12 that he's sending out? Then Jesus went around teaching from village to village. Teaching was number one. That is why BBI is a teaching ministry. And as we teach you, we have to deal with the evil spirits because they're going to oppose us. So we have to have authority. We have to be trained to deal with it because the evil spirits will oppose you receiving the teaching. The evil spirits will oppose you changing as a result of the teaching. Okay? So then Jesus went around teaching from village to village, calling the 12 to him. He sent them two by two and then did them. One of the things that now was very important to him. And gave them authority over evil spirits. What does he understand? He gave them authority over evil spirits. He knew you were going to have to deal with evil spirits. Okay? After he's given them authority over evil spirits, then now he tells them the physical things. Oh, take a bag, don't take a bag, take sandals, don't take sandals. Okay? Verse 12, chapter 6. They went out and preached that people should repent. That was the first thing teaching. We've been called. If you're going to be a fisher of man, you must be able to preach and teach people that they should repent. Okay? Verse 13. They drove out many demons. Many. Why? Because they're preaching and telling people to repent. And the demons did not want them to repent. So it says they drove out many demons. And they also anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. Okay? Preach. Heal. Kick out evil spirits. Okay? Those are the things that he did. Even when the whole city came before him, we are told he healed them all. And then he drove out the evil spirits. He anointed many sick people with oil. And they healed them. They healed them. After that, Jesus. Now we look at the 72. He has dealt with the 12. Now we go to Luke chapter 10 to see maybe when they are more, when they are now, they've grown. They started out with 4, then they went to 12. Now he's working with 72. It's growing. Luke chapter 10 verse 1 says, after this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them 2 by 2 ahead of him, every town and place where he was about to go. The beginning he sent the apostles, the 12 of them, 2 by 2. Now he's sending the 72, 2 by 2. Was Judas one of the 12? Was he given authority to cast out evil spirits?
Yes.
Okay. There is more than just having that authority to cast out evil spirits. Just the fact that you've been given that authority doesn't mean you're going to use it. But we are saying that we are going to use it. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Now we go to the 72. Now we jump. They've already been sent. They've already been told what to do. First of all, in verse 2, we are told, he told them, the harvest is plentiful. Plenty with who? Those who need healing?
and those who are demonized. That is a harvest. You need to understand, when you're going out to the harvest, there are people who need salvation. Number one, they need salvation. They will also need healing. They will also need to be set free from evil spirits. Workers must have authority to deal with evil spirits. A true worker of Jesus Christ, a true disciple of Jesus Christ, must know, must have, it is not an option, must know that they have authority. Not must have, they have it. Because Jesus has said he's already given it. In Luke 10:19, you're going to see that. He says, I've already given you the authority. Okay? The worker in the harvest field must know that they have authority to deal with evil spirits. And workers in the harvest will encounter evil spirits as they are in the harvest field. It is not an option. The problem is either you recognize them or you not recognize them. That is the only difference. There are those who have been trained to recognize them, but there are those who don't know. So they're assuming they don't exist. Today we are training you to recognize them. Because if you don't recognize them and deal with them, they will deal with you. They're there to deal with you. So deal with them first before they deal with you. Okay? Verse 17. The 72 returned with joy. Joy. The ministry of helping people be delivered should bring you joy. Not fear and other things. Joy. Okay? And as BBI, we are always very joyful. We are always sending each other WhatsApp messages. You can't believe what has just happened. I have prayed for such a victory. Then we all send each other SMSs. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Or pray for me. I am right now about to pray for somebody. I'm about to pick out an evil spirit. We all pray. I want you to understand. And I'm so glad that BBI is here to do what was on Jesus' heart. To preach, to heal, to drive out evil spirits. And today you're going to see that amongst this multitude, we are going to be healed and we are going to drive out evil spirits. Because that is what we've been called to do. I see some people looking with fear. Don't worry. Okay? They said, even the demons submit to us in your name. They were so excited. That should be the excitement of every one of you. Evil spirits submit to me in the name of Jesus. I don't fear them. They submit to me in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Then he goes on and tells them that I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Then he says, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. Because that is mainly our fear. People always often ask me, do you sleep at night? Do you sometimes feel like something like evil spirit coming to attack you? No! Because I've already been promised that nothing will harm me. It's a promise. And God does not lie. If he says nothing will harm you, nothing will harm you. Okay? Amen and amen. Now I want us to look at Jesus' last words. We know that when a person is dying, their last words are very important, isn't it? Let us now go to the book of John over Mark, back to Mark. We're going to look at chapter 16. Very last chapter in Mark. Because after this, verse 19 says, after the Lord Jesus had spoken to them, he was taken up into heaven and he sat at the right hand of God. So now we're going back. What had he just told them before he was taken up to heaven and sat at the right hand of God? Okay? Verse 15. Go into the world and preach the good news to all creation. That was always number one on Jesus' heart. He told that he sat the apostles when he first met them, preach the word. And as he's leaving, he's saying, preach the word. Romans tells us, how will they know if somebody doesn't preach to them? We are a set people, set to preach the word. And preaching the word has consequences. One of the consequences is you encounter evil spirits. Okay? Then he says, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. But whoever does not believe will be condemned. Then he says, these signs will accompany you. You believe. These signs will accompany you.
In my name, you will drive out evil spirits. He still talked about evil spirits as his name. Telling them, preach the word. And then a sign that is following will follow you. To show that you're my disciples, you're both, I'm leaving you here. Preach the word. And drive, continue to do what I've been doing. Continue to drive out evil spirits. Okay? And then finally, he tells them, you will place your hands on the sick and they will get well. Jesus' heart is for sick people to get well. Jesus' heart is for the people who are demonized to be delivered. Jesus' heart is for people who do not know him to come to him in salvation. As the good news is preached to them. Then the last verse, verse 20 says, then the disciples went out and preached everywhere. And the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that accompanied it. We have already been told in verse 17, the signs that will accompany the believers, isn't it? As these signs accompanied them, Jesus was working with them and confirming that he was with them. It's a confirmation. These signs and these wonders. Preaching the word, healing the sick, giving out evil spirits. So number one, again, emphasizing in Mark 16, that you preach the good news to all creation. And number two, point number two from there, is that one of the signs that should follow you is driving out evil spirits and healing the sick. Verse 20, the Lord works with us as we preach and cast out evil spirits. We are not doing it on our own. That's why it says, and the Lord worked with them. It's not something I do on my own. It's something I do with the Lord. Then how do I know that the Lord is with me? I see these signs. I see the signs. And the signs are showing me that I'm not alone. That the Lord is with me. Are we together so far? So we have clearly been set out as workers to drive out evil spirits. So that if we have friends around us, because we know that a multitude have problems, isn't it? Even amongst your circle, that multitude around your circle, they need healing and they need deliverance. Okay? So you have been given the authority to go and drive out the spirits. Today we're going to find out how to do it. So now we ask ourselves, who were they to drive out evil spirits from? Who? They have been told, go out and drive out these evil spirits. But drive them out of who? Okay? We're now going to go to Matthew chapter 12 to answer that question. Who do we drive them out of? Verse 43 to 45. He says, when an evil spirit comes out of a man, it goes through dry places seeking rest. It does not find it. Evil spirit comes out of a man. We know that the evil spirits do not come out of their own volition. So basically, you can say, when an evil spirit is driven out of a man, they don't come out of their own. They will go out and they will seek rest. Their rest is in inhabiting a person. Their rest is in having what they call their house, as you're going to see here. And they don't find that rest. Which means evil spirits will not rest until they find a person to inhabit. And we're going to look out today to see who are the kind of people that evil spirits inhabit. So that we can make sure that we protect ourselves from the entry of these evil spirits. So when an evil spirit comes out of a man, it goes through dry places seeking rest and does not find it. Why can they not find a place in another person? There are so many people who are walking in the streets, and when they're so angry, just imagine an evil spirit can just jump in. But the evil spirit did not jump in. They have somebody else in the marketplace, they are mad, they are picking things from the ground. Still, the evil spirit could not enter that one, so he goes back to his house. Why? The same reason I told you. The strong man tells him, where? Don't enter him. This place, this house is mine with the people under me. So he keeps trying to find a house, he finds a strong man with his people. He keeps trying to find another one, a strong man with his people. So he goes back to his home. Then it says, evil spirits can think, they can reason. That because it's speaking to itself. There's reason. Says, I can't find somebody. Then he thinks.
Then says, let me go back to the home I left. I will return to the house I left.
When it arrives, he finds the house unoccupied, swept clean, and put in order. He does not enter immediately. Goes back, verse 45. Then it goes and takes with it seven other spirits, more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of the man is worse than the first. The final condition of the man that the evil spirits were driven out of, because it was unoccupied, swept clean and put in order, it was an empty house. The spirits came back, and now the man is seven times worse. The reason why they came back in was because the house was unoccupied. We never enter houses that are occupied, do we? Because a strong man will kick you out, isn't it? Whoever the strong man is in the world, it's my house. They'll kick you out in the same way. Okay? So when you pray for somebody who is unoccupied, who is the person who is unoccupied? The person who is unoccupied is an unbeliever. The Holy Spirit is not in there to protect that home, to protect that property. Holy Spirit is not in there. So when you kick out an evil spirit from somebody who does not have the Holy Spirit living in them, you make them seven times worse. And yet we have been told, you've seen Jesus kept telling us, drive them out, drive them out, drive them out. He's leaving. Drive them out. So he's leaving and go to heaven. Isn't it? So if he's telling us to drive them out, but out of who? If we drive them out of an unbeliever, they're going to become seven times worse. So who am I to drive them out of? Who do we drive them out of?
Believers.
Okay, thank you. That the six people said believers. Who do we drive them out of?
Believers.
Believers. We're going to see how we drive them out of believers. Okay? So the question we want to ask is, can a Christian open a door? You see? Because when the house is locked, secured, no one can come in. But if you open the door, somebody can come in, isn't it?
Yes.
Can a Christian open a door to evil spirits? We're going to look at Matthew chapter 15. See a very, very interesting exchange that Jesus had with a Canaanite woman. From verse 21. Okay, Matthew 15. Verse 21. He says, leaving that place, Jesus was always leaving some place. I want us to know that we've been sent to the whole world. Wherever you are, sometimes you need to leave that place to go and preach to people. Sometimes you're sitting in front of the television. Sometimes you have to leave that place to go and talk to somebody. You're in a comfortable situation. Sometimes you have to leave that place to go and talk to somebody else. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from the vicinity came to him, crying out, Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is suffering terribly from demon possession. Or rather, my daughter is suffering terribly because she's demonized, because there are evil spirits in her. Satan does not discriminate between children and adults. The door is open, whether it's a child, whether it's an adult, the evil spirits will enter. This child, for some reason, had a doorway. And you're going to find out later on what are the doorways. What are the things that can open the door to my house, that can break the hedge of protection around me. So this woman cries out to Jesus, and we are told Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and asked him, send her away. She keeps crying after us. And he answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me. My child is suffering greatly. My child has evil spirits. How many people even bother to see whether their child has an evil spirit? Don't bother, isn't it? But children have evil spirits. We deal with them all the time. So he says, my child has an evil spirit. Then he replied, it is not right to take the children's bread. What was the children's bread? The children's bread was the ministry of deliverance, of kicking out evil spirits. So he said, it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Anybody who was not an Israelite was called a dog. But before we start getting offended, let's just accept that that is what it was. Huh? Okay? But he says, I cannot take the children's bread, what belongs to my children, what is for those in the kingdom, and give it to the people outside the kingdom. So deliverance, being freed from evil spirits, is our bread. It belongs to us. It is our portion. Jesus is saying, it is for us not to be oppressed by evil spirits. It is our bread. Okay? So Jesus here is saying, it is not for those who are not in the kingdom. But later on, it is faith that now opened the door for her to call Jesus to do something for her. Faith opened the door because she insisted. And she said, even the dogs under the table, they eat the crumbs or from the table that leave the crumbs that fall down. Jesus said, because of your faith, you go back home, your daughter has already been delivered. Which means Jesus did not have to be there personally. He did not have to be there personally. We can pray for people. We can pray for them from where they are. God can still work with people where they are. Because with God, there is no distance. Okay? With God, there is no distance. So what are the things that can break the wall? I ask if the table could just be moved forward, please.